How many ever heard of free radicals? Good. How many heard of trans fatty acids? Yeah, these are common words today. Everybody in the street, even little six-year-old kids, know about these things. And yet doctors continue to recommend to consume free radicals and trans fatty acids. If I were to come out with a product, Dr. Wallach's 100% pure free radicals, the finest trans fatty acids in the world, and I'd label and put them in a health food store, how many people would buy them? Zero. I mean, I wouldn't sell any of them. And yet, everybody listens to the doctors when the doctors say, I want you to use margarine instead of butter. Margarine is nothing more than a big block of trans fatty acids and free radicals. It is pure, 100% trans fatty acids and free radicals. They've killed more Americans with margarine in America than all the wars put together in the 200 plus years we've been a country, both domestic and foreign. And so if you have any margarine at home tonight, I want you to go home and box it up and ship it UPS to Castro. Put a little note in there that says, my cardiologist says this is good for your heart, and I, you know, in a show of good faith, I'm sending you some margarine. And hopefully he'll be stupid enough to use it. And I like to have my patients eat 6 to 10 eggs a day. The more eggs you eat, the lower your cholesterol goes. The more eggs you eat, the lower your cholesterol goes. And I personally eat 6 eggs a day, so I hope you do too. They're great protein, and if you don't fry them, don't fry them, don't cook them in margarine. You want to poach them, soft boil them, hard boil them, soft scramble them in butter at low temperature. This came out in 1995. This little study was presented at the annual meeting of the American Heart Association in Anaheim, California. They said 2 eggs a day won't hurt. And when that report came out in 1995, that sent a shockwave through the entire medical system. Because prior to that report coming out, eggs were the father of the devil. I mean, if you ate eggs, you were doomed. Nobody would hang around you. He's an egg eater. You know? Oh. I really like this one. Makes my 10 look pretty conservative. This came out 13 years ago. New England Journal of Medicine, very respectable medical journal. Normal cholesterol in an 88-year-old man who eats 25 eggs a day. Now, you have to ask yourself, why was this old dude eating 25 eggs a day? Maybe he didn't have any teeth and couldn't eat steaks anymore. Maybe he owned an egg farm and liked to do his own quality control. But I think it was more scientific than that. If you appreciate that 95% of male sex hormone, testosterone, 95% of female sex hormones, estrogen, progesterone, 95% of the weight of our adrenal hormones, our adrenaline, comes from a master steroid in our body. It's made from a master steroid in our body called cholesterol. You can only make 10%. The other 90% must come from your diet. And when your adrenal glands are exhausted, what's the most likely thing that you're not consuming enough of? Cholesterol. When you're sitting there watching TV, guys, when your wife's saying, hey, look at my nice nightgown. Would you rather watch TV or watch me? And she's got you on an egg-free, butter-free, chicken skin-free, red meat-free diet. Yeah. Have you ever wondered why there's no flourishing colonies of egg ants? All sit around and hum. How many heard of Alzheimer's disease? It's a physician-caused disease. Mark my words, in the next 2 years, maybe even next week, it'll pop up in the newspaper. There's more than enough information to prove that it's a physician-caused disease. Alzheimer's disease is a disease that did not occur, even by another name, 40 years ago. It only became recognized as a disease in 1979, 25 years ago. Today, it's the number 4 killer of adults over the age of 65, behind, well, I have to throw in doctors now. Doctors, cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, and Alzheimer's disease. Now, our brains are made up of 75% a fatty insulation material called myelin. How many of you heard of myelin? Good. Well, myelin is this fatty insulation material in the brain. How many of you are eating a brain sandwich, brain and egg sandwich? Oh, you haven't lived until you eat a brain sandwich. It is good. A little bit of onion and mustard. I mean, there's nothing better than a brain sandwich. It's real cheap now because everybody's afraid of, you know, mad cow disease, so I buy more brains and I eat it. But at any rate, This myelin makes up 75% of our brain weight. It's so important to the animal and human brain. Myelin is 75% of our brain weight. And myelin is 100% cholesterol. You can only make 10% of your daily need. The other 90% must come from your food. And if you're very, very good at listening to your doctor's instructions, does that sound familiar? September 2000, Scientific American? If you listen to your doctor and you give up eggs and eat egg beaters, if you give up butter and eat margarine, if you rip the chicken skin off your chicken before you eat it, eat tofu instead of red meat, the odds are you're going to get what? Alzheimer's disease. This came out 4 years ago, March of 2000. Alzheimer's tidal wave is feared. It's coming. They said within the next 25 years, 14 million Americans are going to die of Alzheimer's disease. Today, 25 years backwards, only 250,000 died of it. And 25 years backwards from that, nobody died from Alzheimer's disease. Now, why would you go from zero to 250,000 to 14 million? Well, that's because the baby boomers are coming along, and they listened to the doctors. They believed in technology, and they believed in doctors, and they believed if they followed the doctor's advice, they could be healthier and live to be 100. And so now baby boomers are the ones that get a higher rate and higher percentage of Alzheimer's disease than our older relatives who could care less. Okay? Remember Ralph Charles still flying airplanes at 100? Harold Stilson still hitting in golf hole-in-one at 101? Mizumi Dusty, 161? Still babysitting and singing lullabies and maybe cooking and sewing? We eliminated Alzheimer's disease in animals 65 years ago. This is a human study that came out in July of 1992. Vitamin E can ease memory loss in Alzheimer's patients. This was a study by the University of California, San Diego Medical School and the Salk Institute, infamous for the Salk polio vaccine. They said that vitamin E could bring back a certain amount of memory and make people functional again. Well, nobody could believe that was true, so they redid the study, and 5 years later, they came out with this. Vitamin E might slow Alzheimer's disease. High doses of common vitamin E can slow the devastating decline for some Alzheimer's patients, significantly delaying the need for nursing home care. Again, the University of California, San Diego, University Medical School. Now, if you can delay the need for nursing home care for a spouse or a child or a parent, grandparent, aunt, uncle who has Alzheimer's disease by 5 years, would that be emotionally and financially beneficial to a family? Of course it would. Why don't doctors tell you this? Well, because they own the stock of the nursing home in your town that takes care of Alzheimer's patients. They don't want this to get out. This came out in 2003, November 2003, a study by Tufts University Medical School in Boston. They found out you could reduce your risk of Alzheimer's disease by 48% by just taking either supplements or fish 3 times a day to get the omega-3 essential fatty acids. This has been repeated over and over and over. This just came out January 2004. People taking vitamin C and E were 78% less likely to have a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. Now, they didn't even think about the diet. Getting rid of fried foods and margarines and sources of free radicals. They didn't even think about eating cholesterol. This was just some antioxidants. And so we know from animal studies and these sort of early studies in human beings that if you eat enough cholesterol, not fried, not cooked in margarine, but poached and soft-boiled and hard-boiled and soft-scrambled in butter and meat medium-rare and so forth, which we'll talk about in a minute, and take in antioxidants, the odds of you getting Alzheimer's disease are reduced to almost zero.
I have to go ask my doctor.
Well, he's only lived to be 56. Why would you ask him? Now, how many of you have heard of high blood pressure? Raise your hand. Sure, everybody knows about high blood pressure, a very common disease. How many of you have heard of a veterinarian telling you need to give your dog a calcium channel blocker, a beta blocker for high blood pressure? Not very often. How about your goldfish? What about your parakeet and guinea pigs? You know, every animal can get high blood pressure just like people. The reason why they don't is in these little pellets we talked about earlier, we put things in there so they don't get it. They can get it, but they don't get it because we put the stuff in the pellets so they don't get it. How many of you heard that salt is bad for you when it comes to blood pressure? Salt's going to initiate high blood pressure. How many of you heard that genetics has something to do with it? Well, both of those are wrong. Salt has nothing to do with high blood pressure, and genetics has nothing to do with high blood pressure. It's a simple deficiency of a single nutrient. A single deficiency of a single nutrient. We've eliminated high blood pressure in all these animals. What's the first thing a good farmer puts out for his livestock in the pasture? Salt block or salt lick, isn't it? And there's nobody out in the pasture telling a cow she's limited to one lick a day, is there? And I refuse to believe that my human patients are dumber than a cow or a sheep. Say, look, go ahead and salt your food to taste. Don't worry about it. If you put too much salt on there, it won't taste good. You won't eat it. Remember the Japanese. They consume an entire salt shaker per person a day, 15 grams of salt a day, and they have 85% less cardiovascular disease than we do. And high blood pressure is not even in their vocabulary because they don't get it very often. Well, this came out in July of 1997. It redeemed my view on salt. It says, doctors lack proof that too much salt is unhealthful. After years of telling healthy people that too much salt isn't good for them, researchers still don't have solid evidence to back up that claim. Now, what do doctors call people who give unsubstantiated health and medical advice for a profit? Call them quacks, don't they? So next time you have a doctor who says, look, I need you to give up salt because you're getting to that age, we've got to worry about your blood pressure. Hey, doc, you're a quack. There's no evidence to support that claim. Yeah, I know you want to give me those statin drugs and blood pressure medication, even though I don't have those problems. And you need to go back and kind of read your stuff here because that's not true. Well, there was a wonderful study done by the U.S. government called the Sodium Task Force. Once and for all, they were trying to prove that salt was the cause of high blood pressure. This was published in April of 1997, and this is the bottom line of the study. It was called the Sodium Task Force, 1997. You can look it up on the internet. The study found that people who limited their salt intake to 1,000 milligrams or 1 gram a day, like doctors want you to do, have 6 times more heart attacks, 600% more heart attacks than those who defied their doctors and ate double that amount. If you listen to your doctor, you had 6 times more heart attacks than people who defied their doctors and ate double that amount. So what mineral are we talking about? What mineral are we talking about when it comes to high blood pressure? It turns out it's a deficiency of calcium. Now you can drink 50 gallons of milk a day and you can't get enough calcium to get your blood pressure down. You can eat 25 pounds of cheese a day and the only thing that will happen is you'll be so constipated you'll need a jackhammer to have a bowel movement. If you didn't have hemorrhoids, you're going to get them. You can take all the Tums you want. You can take all the oyster shell, eggshell, limestone, coral, calcium you want. Nothing's going to happen. That's because if you take 1,000 milligrams of limestone or calcium carbonate, which is coral calcium and eggshell and oyster shell, all those are the same chemical formula, you take 1,000 milligram capsule, you're not getting 1,000 milligrams of calcium. Only 140 milligrams is elemental calcium. 860 milligrams is carbonate. And because it's an elemental form of calcium, you only get 10%. So 10% of 140 milligrams is 14. If you take two of those 1,000 milligram capsules of calcium carbonate in any way, shape, or form, you get 28 milligrams of calcium. It's not going to do you much good when it comes to arthritis, osteoporosis, high blood pressure, periodontal disease, et cetera, et cetera. But we've eliminated a lot of high blood pressure in animals and some very famous people who didn't want to use drugs. How many of you have heard of menopause? Raise your hand. Say, now even the guys are raising their hand. Hello, I know about that one. Well, up until about 1958, every doctor used to make 50 cents on dispensing a little herbal formula called Lydia Pinkham's. How many of you heard of Lydia Pinkham's? Yeah. Lydia Pinkham's, very famous herbal formula, and would get rid of the hot flashes, the night sweats. But doctors only made 50 cents when they dispensed a bottle. In 1958, pharmaceutical companies came out with HRT, hormone replacement therapy. And all the research was done by veterinarians, and they were told not to give it to humans because it did terrible things to the laboratory animals as well. That may be true in laboratory animals, but it hasn't been proven in humans yet. We're going to have to kill a lot of women with this stuff before we get, you know, too excited about taking it off the market. And so they began to encourage women to take HRT in 1958.